Tonight, our pastor, Reverend John, to bring us his encouragement on this special day. His fame precedes him. And so shod in stained glass windows, he now comes to deliver.
Merry Christmas. My teacher and mentor and friend and spiritual mother, Dr. Elmer, one Christmas gave me a spanking. She said the pastor shouldn't wear outrageous socks that draw attention away from his message. So I thought to wear something very sober this morning. Stained glass socks. I love Christmas. Welcome. Welcome to all my wonderful Temple family who have come from foreign, and to all of you who are here all the time and every Sunday. And welcome to all those people who join us in consciousness on the World Wide Web. Joy to the world, for truly the Lord, the law, the Savior, the message of love has come in every human heart. Now is the time when mankind is returned to God kind. And I have a special welcome for the Williams family, Andrew, who was one of my teenagers, and Priscilla, his beautiful wife, and their gorgeous daughter, Lael. Now, Andrew really was in, 13 and tall and gangly, and I never knew he would ever know. But of course, we know the Christmas story, it happens. And I am so happy that they're here from abroad and that we will be blessing Lael in this ministry of light and love and truth next Sunday. So don't miss it, because you know that the blessings of the children are just in our hearts. Welcome. About 2 weeks before Christmas, well, all you know what children do to me. I was in my garden and my next door neighbor's six-year-old was making it to come and look at my new fish that I had got. Now, 6-year-olds make me nervous because when I'm not there to keep an eye, I'm nervous about dropping into fish pond, or better still, putting stones, going fishing. So in order to get rid of him, I said, Zachary, have you written to Santa? Now, I know full well children no longer write to Santa. They may text or WhatsApp or whatever you do, but they certainly don't write. So I said, why don't you go inside and ask Mommy for a piece of paper and a pen so you can write Santa? And at that moment, his mother came through the front door, taking him off somewhere. So as she was bundling him to the car, he said, Mom, can you go and tell Uncle John that Santa isn't real? I don't have the heart to tell him. You got to love them. Some people don't believe that Jesus was a real person either, but I would challenge that too. And I remember when I first went to my dad with the story of Santa not being real, he said, no, Santa is real. I am he. And it's me that take my last $200 in those days, or my last 5 shillings to buy you something to put in your stocking. I am real. But if you think about the Christmas story, and this has really been something that's been in my consciousness and in my heart for a very long time. It's so beautiful, While people have arguments about whether he was born on the 25th or what time of year, it couldn't have been the 25th, it must have been in April. And I used to say as a kid, but even the Queen has a birthday that's different, celebrates her birthday on a day that's different to her actual date of birth. So what happens if we want to celebrate Jesus' birthday on the 25th. Nobody is to interfere with my getting Santa's gifts in my stocking. I don't care. I was 18 and still writing Santa. But friends, that story is so beautiful. Mary must have been about 14 or between 14 and 16 years old when she gave birth to Jesus. And this was a very common age for young women to be engaged and married in biblical times. So the Son of God was the son of a teenage mother. And Joseph may have been about 30, a bit older than she was. Joseph and Mary were a very average couple in Israel at that time. They would have been quite poor, and Joseph, as a carpenter, There was an interesting take on this carpenter's job because the priesthood regarded it as sacred service and not as a profession. Mary, and then of course the story makes the point of giving you the lineage so that you can tell that Jesus comes from the line of David. So Joseph came from the line of David. And Mary was also related to the traditional priestly families of Israel through her cousin Elizabeth. Nazareth, the town where they both lived, was a small hill town on a caravan route through the country. It also had a center for the temple priests in which they could come and pray and fast while they were not on duty at the temple. So a wide range of people would travel and visit a town like Nazareth. Well, now, when my brother and I were about 14, he was 14 and I was 10, respectively, our dad would have us read the whole story on Christmas Eve. I think it was to keep us out of mommy's hair so that she could, you know, get through all of the preparations for Christmas Day. But the part of the story that I liked best, and which I didn't have in the readings before because I wanted to read it for you myself, is Luke 1, 26 to 38, when Gabriel tells Mary she will conceive. And I have a story about me and this conception too, which I will share with you. This is the scripture. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God into a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And my Roman Catholic friends, and it was funny, I was cleaning up my bedroom for Christmas, and I found my mother's rosary. And I remember her saying that all the time. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. And when she saw him, she was troubled. You can imagine a 14-year-old girl being visited by a messenger from God. And at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this could be. And so the angel, seeing her fair, said, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. And then this is the part that puzzled me when I was 10. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month with her, who was called barren. Listen to this. For with God, all things, not sometimes, not part of the time, not maybe, with God, all things are possible. Can we say that together? With God, all things are possible. And Mary said, Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. End of that scripture. So we read this one Christmas Eve, and against my father's wishes, I made it into the kitchen. Because I knew that the word no was the default position of every woman that I knew. All the little girls in the neighborhood I wanted to play tea party with, they said no. No. I wanted to do mommy and daddy, and they said no. And I said, but you can't have mommy and daddy if you don't have a daddy. And they say, well, Judy is going to be the daddy, but they wouldn't have me play. So this was very distressing to me. And I went to mommy, and I said, I wouldn't ask my father, because remember, the women are the ones that have the default position. I said to Mommy, what? What if Mary had said no? Imagine an angel telling her that she has to bring this precious expression of love to humankind. And what if she had said, no, I have better things to do. I'm going to be baking a pudding. Or, no, not now, not now. I want to get my degree first. Or, what? Have a baby now? I don't even know this man very well. We need to get to know each other better. What if Mary had said no, friends? Wow. What if Mary had refused that call to give the gift of the Christ to humankind? Well, first of all, if she had said no, there would be no Christmas. She would have flopped that show. We would not be lighting candles on Christmas Eve. We would not be decorating our homes and streets with lights at a time of year when we experience the greatest darkness. I love the symbolism of that. We light candles in the darkest months of the year. We might be decorating a tree, but it wouldn't be a Christmas tree. We wouldn't be opening our hearts to show our love to our friends and families by giving gifts. And we wouldn't be having celebrations in churches or in our homes or big parties elsewhere. And every year I do a Christmas tree in my home. It's a very special ritual for me personally, because I am told, and I had no recollection of this, but I was told when I was older, that when I was yet still about that age, 10 or so, my father, who was a struggling accountant, you know, and earning enough to keep a family, but, you know, really keeping it tight, had provided everything for Christmas. There was ham, there was food in the ice box, as it was in those days. You know, the house had been painted, and everything was in place. And so, a couple of days before Christmas, I'm told, I said, well, where is the Christmas tree? And I was told something that no child wants to hear. There'll be no Christmas tree. We don't have enough money to have a Christmas tree. I am told that I threw the biggest hissy fit and tantrum any picnic could have thrown anywhere. And Daddy was very quiet. And the story goes that on Christmas Eve that year, he was walking up King Street after work, going home early, and there was a tram coming up the road, up King Street. And something said to him, if you just stumble and fall in front of that tram, Dottie, that's what we called my mother, and the boys would have no more problem, because he had just taken out an insurance policy for the monumental sum of £1,500. In those days, that was big money, you know. And this voice said to him, just stumble and fall in front of the tram. And another voice said to him, you must be crazy. You can't create life, so you can't destroy life. It's not yours to play with. And end of story, part one. And next morning when I woke up, there was a perfect Christmas tree about 2 feet tall in my living room, in my parents' living room. Daddy had gone home. He had taken a broomstick and an awl, you know, one of those things that's like a corkscrew? And he had bored holes through the stick from every angle. I mean, it must have taken him all night. And he had taken coat hangers from short to slightly bigger to slightly bigger, and push them in from every angle, wrap them with green crepe paper, and there was one string of lights, which I believe only half of them worked, and he strung it up, and we had a perfect little Christmas tree. And I thought, wow, the gift of love, you know? And I swore, I must have been about 18 when I was told this story, I swore that every year that there would be a tree in my own home decorated for him. And every year, every bauble is put on with a prayer, every bauble, for all the people who give so much and sacrifice so much for their children. And I think about that Mary, you know, if she had said no, that would have been the end of the story. But she said yes to a call which was so magnificent that it changed the course of human history. A third, or almost a third, of the world's population believes and honors and lives by this story and this hope of a better life because Mary said yes. And so, my friends, on this Christmas Sunday, I want to ask you if there is something that life is calling you to be. If there is a mission that God has for you to which you should be saying yes. For you are highly favored of God, and there is something precious that only you can bring to the world, and it is waiting to be born through each of you right now. I don't know, it may be a course of study you want to do. It may be a relationship you wish to heal. It may be the gift of giving something, I don't know. But there has to be something that you want to give to life, and it's waiting to find its perfect expression. And only you can gestate it and bring it to life. Nobody can do it quite the same way as you. And you will be making a difference and creating a world that truly works for everyone. So if there is something calling to you this Christmas, think about saying yes. And I want you to be sure to be at our New Year's workshop preparation next Sunday and Monday's workshop, because we're going to look not just at what we want to get, this getting business that we do every year, we're going to look at what we can be doing to live that life purpose that we have come on earth to live. And yes, we will set our goals for what we want to achieve and where we want to go and what we want to have, but it's going to be in congruence with why you have come to earth. Because the angel is saying to you, hail, you have found favor with God. You have a special mission, and only you can deliver it. Only you can bring it to life, my friends, and it's waiting to be birthed through you. You know, I read all those stories about the miracles, you know, and there are those of my friends who foo-foo and say, you know, what miracles? You know, it's all a myth. We in the science of mind who practice spiritual mind treatment or affirmative prayer, each of us have experienced the miracle that comes from prayer. Am I right or am I right? We know there's no doubt about it, that we are, in fact, our very existence is a miracle. My goodness, what is there to doubt about that? And so, my friends, what we need to do is to practice with diligence. By the way, you notice the new sign? It's a gift of love from Carmen Clark and executed by somebody from a graphic artist and event planner called Michelle, and I've lost her name here for a moment, but it's beautiful. And I wanted just to give Carmen and herself a round of applause. And so the message comes across the centuries, my friends, and I'm going to be talking about the Beatitudes that Jesus gave us in that complete and wonderful Sermon on the Mount. It's supposed to be the most complete record of his work, but I'm going to be dealing with it in 2016. But just two of them that stick out for me now at Christmas, and it's, blessed are the pure of heart, for they shall see God. And you see, this was what it was meant by Mary, being a virgin. She was pure of heart. She had a consciousness of purity. And you can only have a consciousness of purity, my friends, if you put down the judgment and you put down the little isms and the little backbiting and the little jealousies and the little ego things that tend to want you to say to God, no, I don't have time, no, maybe. Check me again next month, you know. I want to start a group in my neck of the woods where we read something from the Science of Mind magazine and talk about it and talk about the spiritual significance. But, I mean, there's always a but. I can't do it right now. Maybe middle of next year. And God is saying, get off your butts and do what you have to do to bring to life that precious thing that is waiting to be birthed by means of you. And the other beatitude is, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. I just want you to sit with that this season, because we sing the peace song almost every Sunday, and Christmas is a time of peace. There's a beautiful silent night, and it's just about having love for humanity and letting that love rule your life and guide your footsteps from day to day and from moment to moment, so that you see each person as that manger. You see in each person that little fledgling, precious thing that is waxing strong and growing in grace and in truth in the hearts and the minds and the consciousness of our fellow men and women all over the earth. What if Mary had said no? What a darkened world it would be, my friends. What a different world it would be. So thank God she said yes. And we are challenged constantly to also, like Mary, say yes to God's call. In my Christmas message to my members and friends, which Carol recommended that you take home, I bless her for that, I share a poem by Elizabeth Searle Lamb titled Christmas Within and Inner Silence. Let me read it for you. Let me give it voice. It's on paper, but let me give it voice for you. Beyond celebration of gift and carol, candle lighting and Merry Christmas, there is another ritual of season when I turn within to the still center of my being, celebrating within the shape of silence, the star radiance, the birth of love, the peace angel, and let vibrations flow out from the center's energy to bless, to heal, to give the gift of radiant love. Friends, when we become that love, when we allow that Christ love to flow through us, when we get our brains and our egos out of the way and allow our hearts to take over, we are dealing with the greatest intelligence that exists. And that is where the truth resides. And when we move into a place of being pure love, everything good comes to us. We don't have to think about it, because life itself becomes something to celebrate. And as we say in Jamaica, every day a Christmas. This festive season, right through the new year, is the perfect time to use your power to send love out into the world. And so your assignment, thought I was going to forget, is to find a way to demonstrate God's love this week. And I know you have been lavishing love on family and other friends. Now your challenge, I'm giving it to you this morning, is to extend that love to people you don't know. And so your assignment is to find a way to show it. Maybe you can rally a few friends to contribute, you know, all the children get 450 toys. If you can take one toy each and take it to a children's home. Maybe you might just pick up a meal on the way from church today and give it to the first homeless person you see on the street. About a week or two ago, I stopped by the open lot near where I live, where there is a settlement of so-called gay, young gay men and women. And I stopped and said to one of them, how many of you live over there? How many of you are in that tent, share those tents? And he said, 24. And so today I'm going to buy some KFC. It's the easiest thing for me. One man said I should really be cooking myself, but I'm a work in progress. I'm going to buy the KFC, and I'm going to take a couple buckets of KFC and some drink, because I have to follow my own assignment. So think about how you can express that love that is in you, the love that the angels are singing in welcome, to find a way to just put it out there in the world, because that's how we're going to change the world and to make it a place that works for everyone. And please turn to your neighbor and say, you are the Christ in Christmas.
You are the Christ in Christmas.
The Christ in me salutes the Christ in you. Gloria in excelsis Deo. My friends, the Christ in me salutes the Christ in you. Thank you for saying yes like Mary. Let us all say together, yes, God, yes. Yes, God, yes. And so it is. Namaste.